Good morning. Coming from the Himalayan kingdom of Bhutan, where the philosophy of gross national happiness was conceived by His Majesty the Fourth King, Jimmy Singhi Wangchuk, I have always believed that the real meaning and value of any endeavor lies in the extent to which it can create genuine happiness. I am, therefore, thankful for the opportunity to be able to speak on why I believe happiness can and must be a primary purpose of business. But first, it may be helpful to clarify the notion of happiness. Indeed, it can mean different things to different people. To many of us, when we think of happiness, we think of a fleeting, though pleasant, emotional experience. To others, it may be regarded at best as a subjective state of mind that can have no role in shaping public or business policy. As such, happiness has tended to be trivialized by society. When society sees no reason to pursue happiness seriously, it is reason enough for academia, business, or politics to ignore it. Our value systems have little or no inclination towards happiness, and their social, economic, and governance structures are incapable of promoting or sustaining it. These conditions continue to create conditions that are actually lowering human well-being through growing insecurity and discontent amid rising inequality, unsustainable consumption, and wastefulness. The alarming accounts of the heavy costs of the real and imaginary gains that we have made, many of which are far higher and deeper than the benefits, deserve greater attention than we have cared to give. The media needs to be more faithful in its reporting to bring out in the open the revelations that are confined to the pages of scientific journals or academic discourses and conferences. For too long, our economic growth figures have blinded us to the social, ecological, and cultural costs that are not reflected in our national or corporate accounts. Our obsession with limitless growth and endless consumption has come at the cost of the non-material human need and the destabilization of our natural world. Our way of life needs to change. Business cannot go on as usual. In this regard, I am most heartened to note that many forward-thinking business leaders are beginning to articulate a broader vision for the purpose of business, to not only include financial success, but to also ask, how can business make a greater positive impact on our society and our planet? Against this background, the question I have agreed to address compels me to share my notion of what happiness is or what it is not. Happiness, I believe, has little to do with the ephemeral sensory pleasures caused by external stimuli or occurrences. Genuine happiness is a sustained state of the highest level of well-being. It arises from a balanced pursuit of the fulfillment of the dual needs of the human mind and body. It is a product of consciously harmonizing material needs or even wants with spiritual and emotional necessities in a just, peaceful, and secure environment. In short, happiness is the highest quality of life and contentment that every citizen must be able to enjoy in a truly flourishing and civilized society. Furthermore, happiness can only prosper if not the government alone, but the society as a whole strive to create the right social conditions, and if happiness skills such as mindfulness, altruism, compassion, and contentment are as highly valued as the more widespread intellectual and academic competencies. This is the reason why, under the wise and able guidance of His Majesty the King of Bhutan, Jimmy Khesa Namgye Wangchuk, Bhutan considers improvement of enabling conditions for happiness to be the purpose of development. This is the reason why variations in the level of happiness among citizens continue to be the main indicator for Bhutan's societal progress. This is why, as the most powerful force of change in the era of the Anthropocene, I believe it is wrong for business to neglect happiness. It is inconceivable for modern society to function without the business of commerce, finance, or industry. It is business that is altering human destiny by the day in extraordinary ways. But if happiness is not the purpose of business, two worrying questions come to mind. One, what are the purposes of business? Two, could these purposes not only be leading society away from happiness, but also hurting it? If the answers to these questions give us no comfort, there is a dire need to re-examine society's values, systems, and actions. There is the urgent need to redirect the purpose of business towards the good of society, fully aware that business does guide society. Indeed, business has the ability and moral responsibility to lead the fundamental transformation that society needs to undertake most urgently for its survival and well-being. Business must nurture happiness, the most sought-after product of shared societal progress. It must begin by accepting the truth that human well-being is the basis of prosperity, which is as much the cause as it is the product of flourishing business. As much as the ingenuity and enterprise of business have advanced society, the state of business itself is in turn conditioned by the health of society. After all, strife, disease, poverty, and the accompanying famine are no environments for flourishing businesses. In recognizing happiness as the timeless aspiration of every human being, it makes absolute business sense to make happiness a primary purpose of business. It is for the same reason that happiness needs to become the most accurate indicator for not only a nation's economic well-being, but its social, political, security, and ecological conditions as well. Business must remind itself that its long-term viability will increasingly depend on how its function, processes, or products change human conditions that affect societal happiness. It will hinge on how it can gain consumers' confidence and trust as being genuinely engaged in producing, selling, and distributing goods and services that enhance their well-being without destroying the natural environment. Business must not fail to note the changing behavior and demand of the consumer for greater ethical and moral responsibility. The business environment is evolving rapidly. Populations are becoming less impressionable and more demanding of social, health, and ecological accountability. They are pushing the state, the media, and the international community in ways that are directly impacting business. Profit cannot be the primary purpose driving business. The term sustainable brand must go beyond its rhetoric or even its literal meaning, to bring about a new business ethos, a new business sensibility. Business must grasp and bring to bear the full ethical nuance of the term so that such claims as social or ecological responsibility and service to community that are muddied by less honest motives become truthful. Sustainable brands must mean business that is not divergent from and supportive of the purpose of human life and the well-being of the planet. A business that is able to align its purpose with the ultimate human aspiration is one that will become successful and sustainable. Happiness, being that aspiration of both the individual and the collective, must become that purpose. This is what will give business the ethical vision, moral strength, and innovative energy to move away from purposes that serve only the cause of short-term gain. It is happiness-driven business that will gain the satisfaction of knowing that its products are of meaning and real value to society, with no costs that are hidden or unintended. Business and society are interdependent. Therefore, the two must strive to coexist harmoniously. It will be this genuine mutuality of interest between business and society that will build the vital bond of trust and respect so critical to the sustainability of business. Such must be the basis on which business will earn the sustainable brand, be valued for it, and thrive because of it. From the Bhutanese perspective, indeed that of the GNH Center, which I represent here today, a business that carries the sustainable brand must be one that is committed to promoting as many of the nine dimensions that we believe directly impact human and societal well-being. This must be demonstrated in its governance practice, its policy pursuits, its products and their sources, as well as the means by which they are acquired or extracted. Of equal importance are product durability, disposability, and distribution process. The nine determinants that I refer to include justice, equity, gainful employment, healthy environment, and physical, mental, intellectual, cultural, as well as relational vitality. The reward of gaining such a sustainable brand will be immeasurable at a time when the search of meaning and purpose of life is gaining momentum and people are beginning to see the threats to sustainability as immediate and of direct consequence. The returns in terms of trust, respect, and loyalty, not only from customers, but from proud, happy employees, will be profound, with telling impact on innovation, productivity, and product quality. The gains from tax incentives could be substantial as well. So too will be the higher reward of inner satisfaction. As president of the Gross National Happiness Center Bhutan, I am delighted to share that the Begrim Group, which focuses on conducting business with compassion, has recently partnered with our center to implement the principles and values of GNH at all levels of their organization. It is committed to developing happiness skills so urgently needed in our time. I am therefore very pleased that the GNH Center Thailand is being established as a humble contribution from Bhutan to help bring GNH in practice in the business sector in this beautiful and peace-loving country. In concluding, I would like to congratulate the sustainable brand organizers, the esteemed speakers, and all the keen participants on coming together in search of a more sustainable and happier way of life. Kop Kun Ka. Thank you.